the storm that you've gone through. Don't give up. Cause it can.
Karibuni sana. This evening we are happy to have you. Welcome Moses Owili Yoma. It's a pleasure to have you tonight. Thank you, Godwin. Again, you're very much welcome tonight. It is good to have you. Please let us know where you are from. And share as widely as possible and join us tonight. Even as we have our family hour, we pray together, we fellowship, ask questions, and also follow us on social media and on YouTube. We will be glad to have you. Thank you so much, Jane Onyambu. More shalom to you. Peace and prosperity be your portion. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Will Brother. Say hi to your family for us. Thank you for coming online. And even for the silent followers, we appreciate you. We thank you so much for joining us. You're very much welcome. Thank you, Mama Joyce, as well. You're alive and you're alive. You're very much welcome. So I would like us just to get into prayer because we are beginning a bit early today. Thank you, Mom Pamela. Thank you for having us. We love you so much together with your family. May the Lord bless you. So let us get into prayer before we get into the word tonight in the name of Jesus. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless you and we worship you. We exalt your holy name. We thank you, Father, because you are God all by yourself. You are God omnipresent, omniscient. You are God, our present help in time of need. Tonight we surrender our lives to you. We lay aside every burden. Lord, even we lay it at your feet, O God, that we may receive what the Holy Spirit is speaking to us tonight. O my Father, thank you for watching over us throughout the day. Lord, you have kept us and our family members, O God. My Father, you are keeping us in good health, O God. You are keeping our mind in perfect peace, even as we focus on you, my Father. The world has its challenges, but we look unto you, Jehovah. You are the foundation. You are the light, O God, that we need, O my Father. You are everything that we need. Master, you are the truth that we need, O God of glory. The world may be going through turmoil, but Father, we are hidden in you, my Father. We are hiding in your presence tonight. Your name is our strong tower. We run unto it. We are safe. We are safe against every wile of the devil. We are safe, my Father God, against sickness and disease, against every perilous time in the name of Jesus. We bless you, Lord of glory, for our family members far and wide from us, O God. Lord, because of time and distance and the lockdown, we cannot reach to them. But Father, we remember them in prayer tonight in the name of Jesus. We call those that don't know you, O God. May they come to the knowledge of truth in the mighty name of Jesus. May you open the eyes of their understanding that they may know that you are the way, the truth, and the life. May you give us a hunger and the thirst for righteousness. May you teach us the way in which we should go. May we hear your voice showing us the direction which we need to take, O God. Master, we bless you and we worship you. Lord God Almighty, for our government, we pray for divine direction from above. In the mighty name of Jesus, we nullify every scheme of the enemy, every confusion of any kind. We arrest you in the mighty name of Jesus. Any opposition, we bind you in the name of Jesus Christ, O God. Father, we pray that, Lord, you will watch over us, O God. The safety of the land belongs to you, Lord God. The nations and the continents belong to you, Master. I pray that, Father, you will keep us with your righteous right hand in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, oh my God. Father, we pray, oh God, for the nations of the world, that, Lord God, in this time we shall seek your face, we shall know you in reality, we shall experience you in a higher dimension in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you and we worship you. Even as we receive the word tonight, may it be a transformational word into our hearts. Lord, the Bible says that faith comes by hearing and by hearing. Lord, we hear, Lord, not only with our physical but with the spiritual ears as well, that we may be transformed into the likeness of Christ. Lord, our families are set by God. Father, we declare you are the foundation of our homes, you are the covering of our families, you are the pillar, the surrounding of our relationships. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, there shall be oneness in our families, there shall be unity and love in our families. We speak harmony in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Where there is lack of peace, may you step in. We call you the Prince of Peace, oh God. We call you the King of Kings. May you take preeminence in our homes tonight in the name of Jesus. Master God, I thank you that you are speaking tonight expressly by your Spirit. Lord, empty your servant and fill him up with you, that he may speak accordingly, oh God of glory. Change and transform our lives. Better us for your glory, oh God of glory. We thank you and we love you tonight. In Jesus' name we pray and believe. Amen.
Well, we appreciate God's grace and his wonderful love to us as a family of God. And as we say, you are the reason why we meet every evening to have fellowship with you and to share in the things that the Holy Spirit is directing and teaching us as a family. Because without you and without your presence, our being here is in vain. And so we thank God for you. You are our very most precious family members. And we love you, we cherish you, we honor you. And we do not want to take your time for granted. For you to put aside your evening relaxation and preparation of your family to go to bed, and you take this 1 hour in your busy schedule in the evening just to sit and hear what the Lord has to say, God also doesn't take it for granted. God knows that you are serious and he is willing to speak a word in your heart. I want you to know that God will always give us something that is relevant to you. Not every word spoken may be relevant, but there is that one part of the whole saying and the whole speech that is very relevant to you. And so as you pay attention, the Holy Spirit will single out one very important word for your life. And so we appreciate you. We've been looking at the series of teaching in the restoration of the divine structures in the family. And we've been looking in the past few days on the issue of the rightful place of the man in the family. I want to, before I begin to say something tonight, I want to first of all apologize for yesterday. We couldn't get on air because our equipment broke down. And we thank God that he has enabled us to find a way to continue with our programs of the evenings. So keep praying for us because we are at war at the same time. So God bless you for your patience and for your understanding. This day, I want to look at the topic of the restoration of man's scepter. The restoration of man's scepter. A scepter is the rod of authority to rule. It is the place of dominion. It is the throne of governance. It is the authority that gives you the place to have dominion. So God's place in the life of man is to exercise the dominion, is to exercise the command. And so Genesis chapter 49, let it be our study scripture. The Bible says, Judah, verse 8, Judah, you are he who your brothers shall praise. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's children shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He bows down, he lies down as a lion, and as a lion, who shall rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh comes. And to him shall be the obedience of the people, binding his donkey to the vine, and his donkey's colt to the choice vine. He washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. His eyes are darker than wine, and his teeth are whiter than milk. Now these are words of prophecy that Jacob spoke over his son Judah. Of course, he had 12 sons, and each one of them received their word of prophecy, which determined their redemptive calling in their genealogies. And he spoke about Judah. And when he spoke about Judah, he was seeing from a distance prophetically that there was going to rise a person or a man or a seed in the lineage of Judah that is going to restore rule back to the earth, and especially to man. And so he spoke these words to Judah, and he said, you are he whom your brothers shall praise. The reason is this: from the day that Adam fell, man entered into a very confusing state of affairs and events, because he lost his estate, he lost his authority, he lost his dominion, and he lost his position as a son of God. And so his manhood was affected, and his character as a true man was affected. And because of that, you remember that when sin came, it is Adam that held the hand of the wife, and they hid themselves from God. In other words, they entered into a place of embarrassment, of shame, of intimidation. They entered into a place where they felt inferior. And because of that, that spirit began to haunt man all along. And so man, in his state as the authority that he lost, has been fighting to find a place for himself. He's been fighting to find recognition. And so it is a cat and mouse kind of race that has been on the back of a man to find a place of recognition, a place of honor, a place where he feels complete. And it looked from that time that it was not possible without the appearing of the man that Jacob is prophesying of. And so he says, Judah, you are whom your brothers shall praise. The reason is, out of you, Judah, men are going to come back again to the place of honor and a place where they will recognize their place and position, and they will begin to worship properly again. So it is a place where they'll conquer. Through you and through your seed, you are going to raise men who will champion a new dimension of culture. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. In other words, you are restoring the warrior grace and the warrior anointing back to man. Your father's children shall bow down before you. That is to say, you are going to be deserving of honor again and respect, where now your worth is going to come back. And so he speaks of powerful things to Judah. He says, Judah is a lion's whelp. And he says, from the prey, my son, you have gone up. He bows down, he lies down as a lion, and as a lion, who shall rouse him? Now he is speaking about, of course, the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is seeing the lion of the tribe of Judah, who is going to be the true lion, not just as the devil is roaring like a lion, but Jesus is the true lion, who is a ferocious hunter and a commander. When he roars, all animals bow. So the authority that Jesus is bringing with him is to bring man to that place of roaring again like a lion. To be a ferocious hunter. That is to say, whoever rises up in the name of Satan to try and usurp the position of a man, the man is going to be bold to handle it like a lion. That's why the Bible says, you shall be as bold as a lion. And so he says, the scepter shall not depart from Judah. Now, once you become part of the tribe of Judah, born again, spirit-filled, tongue-talking, child of God, having been given back the right to be called the Son of God, then that rod of authority to rule is handed back to you. That's why Jesus said, all authority in heaven has been given to me. And so behold, I give unto you power. And so there is a good place for man to become who God expects you to be. John chapter 19, verse number 5. The Bible says, when Jesus was tried in the house of Pilato before he was crucified, there was nothing wrong that was found in him. The Bible says, then Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate said to the crowd, behold the man. Now we have the man. We have been lacking a role model. We have been lacking a man who would stand out boldly and stand out in the crowd. A man that the wind obeys, the seas tremble when they see him, the mountains shake, demons tremble when they hear his name. This is the man. And now this second Adam, he has come to be introduced as our role model of the man. Because even now, we are still seeing the devil still pretending. He is trying to prove that he is still in authority. And so he is trying to paint a picture to men that because we are living in a world that has rigid set expectations to men, then men ought to be living in an inferior life. It is true. We cannot despise the state that man has been placed in. But I began by introducing your rightful position as God is expecting you to be. You need to be the man in authority. So, it is true that we are living in a world that has rigid set of expectations and perceptions and definitions of who a man is and should be. The world is vicious for the boy child at the time we are living in today. And the men also in their adulthood, they are facing a lot of challenges. And like women who grow into womanhood without too much pressure, because a man must prove he is a man. He must fight for his rightful place. And he's doing that right from his childhood. And has to continuously do so right into his adulthood and into his old age. But women are generally wired to be admired, to be respected, and given a privileged position within the family and the society at large. And so, they are in a more advantageous position today than the boy child and than the men. That's why today you look at colleges and other marketplace where jobs are now being dished. It looks like the graph is changing. Where we had dominance of men, now women are taking over in terms of businesses, in terms of corporate management, in terms of all other sectors, doctors, engineers. And there's a saying today that what man can do, women can do better. Which I really don't believe it should be so. But this is a saying that has been pumped so much into the girl child that the boy child is feeling intimidated and insecure today. And as the young men are growing in our time, for the past almost 40 years, most of the men that have grown in this dispensation have grown up with that understanding that women are more preferred now than men. And that's why you find even in schools and colleges, the women today are doing better in grades than our boys. And you look at the number of people or men who are put in prison today, the rate is alarming. All our prisons in this nation and many nations of the world, they are overflowing with men. So homes are being left without the authority that deserves to be there. We have so many absentee fathers because they are looking for how to take care of their families. So many boys in the homes are growing without their father because the father is there but not there. He is away somewhere looking for money. And we have so many challenges that are going around the man that if we do not address it and bring man back to that position that Christ has purchased for us, then we are losing it along the way. So women are now even struggling to find themselves a man. They have a male in the home that is not an authority. And so time has come for us to see men rising up and become men. Because women have been given a place of honor so much that it looks like we are disadvantaged even in our own homes. It is like they have a privileged position. Am I speaking against gender? No. Am I against women? No. What I'm trying to say is that we must come to a place where order and decency is exercised in our families. And it's important for us to voice this, because if not, our girls, our women are now entering into a more dangerous position of vulnerability. Because when somebody is pushed to the wall, they hit back. And the reason why we are seeing a lot of violence in our homes against women, it is not because men are brutes. It is because they have reached a dead end and they are feeling like they must gain back their position. So men are fighting to regain their respect. They are fighting for their space again, and they want to go back to the place where they own and they belong. So to a man, respect is a product of achievement. To obtain excellent victory over someone or surpass the expectation placed on him by the family or by the society. A man is only congratulated when they have done something good. Otherwise, there is a lot of negative words that are heaped upon men until they feel like they do not belong anywhere. So the pressure to perform is always at the mind of men, because the cutthroat competition is always present where he is concerned. Whether in college, whether in games, in the home, in the workplace, or general society, men are under pressure. Therefore, insecurity is part of being a man. It has become part of their norm. So men feel insecure. Sometimes he goes into the house, and so he has to hide behind a newspaper or behind watching football, because inside there is a place of insecurity. There's a place of feeling lonely. There's a place of lack of acceptance. And so men are struggling to be who they are supposed to be. And this is making men to be very insecure. And this one is making most of our girls and most of our women and wives to not understand men. Because they don't understand why men are behaving the way they are behaving. But a time has come for also the ladies to understand the position of men, the insecurity, the pain they are going through, the pressure they are undergoing, the pressure of life that is on top of their heads. Because for a man to break through the shell of his fears, he must step up achievable, he must set up achievable goals. That is why men enjoy games. They enjoy where there is the scoring of goals. So they are thinking of, what can I score to gain my position back, to gain praise again, to gain acceptance again, to gain accolades again. And so they are struggling in college. When they come back with a lower grade, nobody really cares about them. And so they have to work hard to score a higher grade. In the place of work, if they don't perform well, they don't receive a lot of praise. But I want you to know that there are women in the same place of work. Their performance level is very low. But because the bar is lower for women, it is acceptable for them not to really perform. But for men, the bar is very high. And so the pressure continues to mount. So a man who refuses to be refuses to back down from the challenges always gets motivated to accomplish great things. A man who says, I'm not going to be bogged down by any pressure. A man who says,
I am going to be who I am, and I'm going to do what I am able to do and do it well. That man who is not being governed by the performance pressure of our time, that man will be motivated to do greater things. So your motivation is not in looking at how other people are doing what they are doing. Because if you compete with other people, your mindset will not be working as you should. Because eventually, you'll begin to do things that you don't fit to do. They are far too ahead of you, and you will enter even much more pressure. People go into loans to buy houses. People go into loans to buy cars. People go into purchasing things they didn't need to purchase, or they want to travel to nations they never wanted to, so that they can fit into a certain class. Just grow. Just allow God to lift you from glory to glory. And as you grow, you will enter that place and that space without any more harassment. Most of us, and many of us, have just grown comfortably. We began from very low level, ground zero. But we have seen God raise us. You know, there's a time my wife was showing me our photographs that we used to have in Mombasa, in Kisauni, and how we used to put on, and the way we were in Malindi, and the kind of house we lived in. And she would laugh. Now we can laugh. Then it was a struggle. And we have seen this God being very faithful, raising us from glory to glory to glory to glory. So do not despise where you are. Don't try to fit into a class that you don't qualify for. The reason why many men live a life of corruption, and they live a life of wanting to steal or to kill so that they may have what they want, is because they have put themselves under unnecessary and undue pressures. Do not put yourself in undue pressure. Allow yourself to mature into the grades and the levels that you need to grow into, so that you are not under the pressure to prove who you are. Listen, you are a man. Just be who you are. So as a man, you must purpose to be a man that is productive in your own level and at your own capacity. Don't desire to consume what you cannot produce. Do not swallow, or do not bite what you cannot swallow. Just do it in your own proportions, as is acceptable at this level. And don't allow anybody to despise your position, because tomorrow you will be what God has called you to be. Because the greatest frustration in most men is when they cannot meet their goals in life, and they give up the position of trying to fight or pushing on. Many of them decide to retreat to a safer ground, a place of compromise, or choose a life of trying to live in luxury and entertainment that they cannot even afford, which eventually leads them to a serious decline of their effectiveness in life. And so they get little money and they squander it, because they are not planning well. They are not seeing where they are going. They are not actually having a vision to press on. And they have reached a place where they have become numb to any criticism from either society or the family members or the wife or even the children. And so they are just there. It doesn't matter what the children are saying or anybody is saying. It's because in their heart they have gone back into their own cocoon. So it doesn't matter what you do, but you don't need to give up on life. You still have many years to live. So don't throw in the towel now. You just need to allow God, who sent his son Jesus Christ, to restore you back to your position of authority, to help you rise and be who God intends of you. Do not put on a show in public, but yet you are struggling in private. We have so many people who put on a big show up there, driving a good car, but they don't have even money to pay the rent for their houses. Driving a car that they have spent almost 2-3 million to buy, but they are parking it in a rental house that doesn't belong to them. And they cannot even have the audacity to go back to their village because they don't even have a house there. So you are struggling to fit into a class that you don't fit in. My friend, it is not wrong for you to ride a bicycle as you are settling up yourself. And don't allow yourself to be put under pressure because of the neighbors or because your wife wants this done and you can't afford it. There are priorities that you must set as a man. Set up priorities that will put you in a place that you can save and you can build up and establish a good foundation for your family. Why should you go for a 50-inch television which is consuming from you, is eating money? You want the super TVs or whatever you call them. Eh? What do you call those TVs? Smart TV. You want a big 50-inch smart TV that you must have a Wi-Fi to operate. So you need bundles every day to have it running. It is just consuming from you. You don't need to go there. You know, when we started, for many years, I never had a television in my house. Not one. The only time that we had a television is when my children demanded that we have a television. And listen, somebody gave us the Great Wall of China. And of course, that Great Wall of China was eventually stolen. So, and it didn't bother me. It didn't bother me. I kept on moving on. I was cultivating my land in Kitale, planting maize, and being productive so that first I may take my children to school. I may be able to feed them and clothe them, because television was not a priority. And many other things were not a priority. So what you need to know is grow as you are able. Swallow what you can bite. Do not try to choke yourself with what is impossible at this time. I used to buy bend down boutique clothes. And I was not embarrassed. I was a preacher, my friend. I was preaching even when I had a church in Kisumu. I used to go to Kibuye to buy some wonderful bend down boutique shirts. And I was not embarrassed. Actually, when I came into Kisumu, I had only one Kaunda suit. I would wear it in the morning, during the day. In the evening, my wife would wash it and iron it in the night. In the morning, I'm putting it on to go to the morning glory. And nobody would know. And I was preaching very powerfully, and the anointing was not hindered just because I had only one Kaunda suit. No, I didn't have a suit for a long, long, long time. The day I bought a suit and I came on Sunday wearing a suit, some of my deacons marveled. They kept on saying, "Pastor, today you are very smart." Hello? And I said, "Thank you." Because at least now they can say I'm smart. But it didn't bother me whether you tell me I'm smart or not, and I know what I'm doing, it doesn't bother me. Glory to God. So stop putting on a show in public and struggling in private. You can't even feed the children in private. The school fees has not been paid. And here, you are buying people beer. You go to the bar and you say, "Come out to leave you." They will never come and congratulate you. You are just trying to prove that you are a man to wrong people who don't care about you anyhow. When you will not have it, they will not even follow you. They will not come and help you. Actually, when you will not have it, they are the ones who will laugh at you. When I was in the Air Force, I used to go to my village. Those days I was not born again, I would go to the village and I want to prove that I'm a warrior, I'm a soldier. And I would come with packets of cigarette. I would buy whiskey, Captain Morgan, and all those very expensive whiskeys, and carry with it and come home. And I'd gather my friends and we would drink, and they would congratulate me, and they would say powerful names. The day I was put in prison, none of them visited me. None. When I came from prison, no shirt, no shoes, no clothes, no extra change of clothes. None of them even visited me in my home. Every time I meet with them, they would wave at me because I'm no longer worthy walking with them. So you can try to please people, but the people you are pleasing have no interest in your welfare. They have only interest in what you are able to supply to them. And so stop trying to prove who you are. Just be yourself. And the Lord will give you the ability to grow. A day will come when you will be admirable, when they will come for you, when your children will put on nicely. And so don't allow competition to push you to the corner and to distress you. Many men are dying too early because of pressure. Just because of pressure. Their health is failing, because they feel they are not fitting in the company. And because of that, their lives have become miserable. My friend, I'm here to save you. I'm praying for you. That actually, one of the messages I wanted to preach is, I wanted to ask women, and I'm asking that to happen, our girls and women, please pray for the salvation of our men. Because the more we are losing our men are in death and despair and mental health and in prisons, in crime, I assure you, a day is coming when the scriptures will begin to be fulfilled, and they are actually being fulfilled right now. Because Isaiah said a time will come in the last days when seven women will get hold of the skirt of one man, and they'll say, just give us a name, please, let me know as your wife, but I will feed my children, I will eat my own food, but just give me a name. And this is what is happening. We have more women looking for men than before maybe 40 years ago. What we are seeing today is alarming. Because listen, the greatest disease and the greatest desire and the greatest need of women now, they are looking for men who can just be men to them. We have so many orphans, and it's because many of our people are perishing. Most of them are dying in wars, in battles, in drugs, in alcoholism, in accidents, and many other things. You know, I remember there's a time in 2018, I saw a newspaper, Standard newspaper, on 14th of December 2018. There was a World Health Organization report warning on the danger that men are going through. And this is what they said. Let me quote. They said, psychologists have warned that domestic pressure and the need to be recognized and accepted by men are the core reasons why men are dying earlier than expected. Statistics by the World Health Organization indicate that women are outliving men by a considerable margin. They say the greatest battle a man faces is within his own family. Studies have shown that many men are subjected to verbal and physical abuse in their own homes. Most of the cases are mostly concealed, where you find even mature men, okay, boys, are aligning with their mother and abusing their own fathers. They say hiding their predicaments is meant to avoid backlash from society which considers men strong and the head of the family. Researchers have found out that men subjected to abuse had a higher chance of dying within a very short time. Actually, most of them die prematurely. Stress imposes adverse physical effect on health, causing depression and other mental illnesses. Men have fewer people within their social network compared to women, whom they can share their problems with. This is to say, when men go to the club, they're not really going there to share their problems. They're just going there to drown their problems. They are going there to prove who they are, but they don't really have somebody they can share their needs very efficiently and effectively. And because most of them are going through the same cycle of abuse, they do not know how to help each other. And so they continue to say, if we are going to save our men, strong emotional support from friends, relatives, and family members is good for their health. While there are organizations that support women regarding abuse and discrimination and crime and domestic crimes in their families, such initiatives are minimal for the men. Even now, we have hospitals that are only dedicated for women and the gender issues. We have organizations that are fighting for women, many of them. We even have the legal fraternity that are fighting for women. But our men who are in the legal sectors rarely fight for their men. And so men are endangered in our time. This is what the report is saying. The report further records that these are some of the factors that have been linked to rise of suicide among men. Because there are economic factors, mental situations, and lack of social support. The cost of living has been on the increase, and there is a general sense of hopelessness in the lives of men. And things are even getting worse. With most breadwinners being the men, they feel the pressure to provide is intensifying on them. Boys are now taking cue from men, and when they do not see that things are not working out the way they expected from their fathers, some of the boys are also simply giving up and going into drugs and abusing women and rape and other murderous activities that they are getting involved in, because they are seeing what is happening to their fathers, to their men, and so they have entered into a level of despair as well. We have a lot of young people who are unemployed despite having completed various courses and training in college and universities. Coupled with the sense that they are failures is one of the reasons to explain the increase in crime today. And most of our young people are either being killed because of crime, or they are on the streets because they have become street boys, or they are being thrown into prisons because at least there they are being fed, and they would rather stay in prison. Now, many of them are now abusing drugs. They are in substance abuse and alcoholism. They are in suicide. And that's why they do no longer care of what happens, because they are looking at their men. They are looking at those they think should be their role model, and they see despair and they see hopelessness in their faces. And they feel they are not better. Some of our boys have been born and they have never seen their fathers. They have not seen, they don't have one role model that they can look at. Some of the boys are asking themselves, who will mentor me? Who will show me the way? And so they are becoming rebellious to their single mothers because they are not finding the solution they are looking for in the single mother. And so there is a challenge. And because of this challenge, we need to pray for our men. We need to have more activities that are going to bring men on the table. And I thank God because we are now seeing many churches organizing men programs, men's fellowships, and men seminars so that we can bring back man to the table where he's supposed to be and that he can take back his scepter of authority as Jesus has already set an example for us. So I want to urge men, when you hear that we have a seminar for men, come. Don't go into your own cocoon. There are things we can learn from one another that are more important because we cannot mentor you outside the presence of others. So when we call men into a seminar or a men's summit or a conference, let's organize ourselves because there is need for us to restore back man into his rightful place according to divine order of God. So we need to pray for our men. Now, as I conclude, for us to overcome the toxicity of this generation, we must accept the challenges and develop the intelligence to dare to do great things through Christ Jesus. The Bible says, Philippians 4 verse 13, Paul speaking, he says, I can do all things through Jesus Christ who strengthens me. That's why your number one companion should be Christ. You should learn more. He is the best mentor as Christ. We need to go back to the book. Let's study. There are numerous books right now on shelves in bookshops that are teaching on men's mentorship and boy child mentorship. We need to go back there and study because you cannot give to the world that which you are not given. You cannot mentor your son if you are never mentored yourself. You cannot father somebody if you are not fathered yourself. So if we want to go far, let's have somebody. You probably don't have a father or you don't have maybe a role model or a father figure in your life. And I want to say to all the single mothers, if you are having a son, the best is this: try as much as possible to get a father figure. You don't need to get married, but there are father figures in your cycle of reach. Maybe an uncle, maybe even your own father, maybe your brother, maybe somebody you value, maybe a pastor that you have looked at him and you know that he is able to direct and give direction to my son. Let your son relate with this man so that he may learn things that they need to learn. There are things that, mama, you can never give to your son. Because you fall short. You don't know how men behave. You don't understand the things that men desire. What is it that drives a man? You may probably not know. But I want you to know this. Get somebody who can be a mentor. And it shall be well with you. The Lord bless you so much. And so as we continue with our fellowships, may the Lord help you and equip you and enable you to go further in your life and to do what you ought to be doing to the glory of the name of the Lord. And as a man, keep fighting. Be strong. Be like Gideon with his team. They kept fighting in spite of the battles and the things that people were doing against them. So keep fighting and the Lord will tremendously bless you. I want us to pray this night in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. I want us to pray and believe God for the greater things that God has in store for us. In the name of Jesus. Precious Father, In the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you. I glorify you for all that you're doing. May your grace abound to us. All this that we have spoken to men, Lord, may your hand rest upon all men. May your grace abound in their lives. May you give them the wisdom, the knowledge, the understanding, and the ability to excel. In the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, you are the Lord. You pass through what men are going through. Jesus, you experience what we are experiencing. You are under our same pressure of life. And because you succeeded, Jesus, you are able to give us a way forward. May your favor rest upon us and upon all men. I pray for all boys. The Lord God, you will stabilize us and give us a stout spirit. Give men the stamina to overcome all the pressures of life and the cutthroat race that they are in at this moment. The Lord, they will overcome every toxicity that the world is bringing against them. Father, we thank you because you're a good God. In Jesus' name we do pray. And everybody shouted amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. We love you. Let's meet again tomorrow. In Jesus' name. Amen.